If you're a woman who has always wanted to have the courage to step out of your comfort zone but are not sure how, you are going to want to listen to today's podcast. If you're a woman over 40 and you are looking to lose weight for the last time, you are in the right spot. Welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. My name is Nicole Simonin and I'm your host. And we all know that we need to move more and eat less, but why don't we do it? I give clients the skill sets they need through fitness, nutrition, and most importantly, mindset, because that's the missing piece to all this. So if you've tried a ton of diets and are still looking for the latest and greatest 12-week workout program and still haven't seen results, it's the mindset part that is missing for you. So when you become a client, you will not just learn how to lose a weight, but you're going to learn how to keep it off for life. I hope you will enjoy this podcast, and when you're ready to lose the weight for the last time, head over to shapeitupfitness.com and schedule your strategy session where possibility starts and results begin. Welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. Thank you everyone who is leaving reviews and sharing this podcast. We have been holding steady at the top 200 in the fitness category over on Apple Podcasts. So yay! So thank you guys so much for listening and thank you for continuing to share. So today's guest, we're going to talk about courage. And my guest today is a national board certified educator who has dedicated her career to inspiring students, teachers, and administrators through positive learning experiences. She believes that courage is the critical ingredient for personal transformation. She is also building a community of courage beyond the classroom to support kids and adults. You can catch her sharing stories of courage so people can learn to thrive, not just survive, on the Courage Up podcast. So welcome, Ming Shelby. And I know I got your, I know I got your last name right because I get it wrong every time on everybody else's last name. So Ming, thank you so much for being here. I'm so thrilled. We met each other through Brilliantly Resilient. I don't know what they called it, like a recap Wednesday.
What's up Wednesday?
So Ming and I were both featured on the Brilliant Resilient podcast. Or live show, I guess, either version. And so then they brought us together, and I'm so glad we did because Ming and I have, I feel like I've known you forever, but we've only known each other for a couple weeks.
I know. I feel the same.
And we're matching today. So if you're on the video,
Not
planned. All right, Ming. So tell the listeners a little bit about your past and how you kind of wound up where you are today.
So it started in 2018 and I chose a year of courage and I started in August. Like you said, I'm an educator. So everything starts in August and not January. So I'm one of those people who buys the planner that starts in August, not the January one. So I was just going through the motions of going to work and I didn't really feel like I was showing up as my full self. Like, I felt like there were moments where I could have spoken up or said something, but I really chose to stay small. And that kind of like ate away at me. And I didn't really know the effect that it was having on my family and all that kind of stuff. So I really chose courage to just be like, I'm going to show up, stand my sacred ground, and speak my truth. And it was hard because there were a lot of moments that I felt challenged, like, is this a time that I speak up, or the team is having this discussion? Do I interject, or my boss wants this to happen? And I realized I was really looking for their validation, for like, I'm doing a good job of feeling valued. And that's where I was kind of projecting all of my efforts. And slowly I realized it wasn't about them valuing me, but it was really that I needed to value myself. My year of courage was more about like being true to me and that internal voice of I'm good enough, I can do this, I'm valuable. And so on that journey, what really helped me was hearing stories from my friends who've been going through this same thing. One of my really close friends, she was going through a divorce at the time. And we had these parallel lives. It was so weird that like her personal life was kind of, and my work life was kind of like, and we would have like these same situations. So out of that, and her support, was born the Courage Up podcast, where we share stories of courage, because that really helped me be like, okay, I'm not in this alone. There's other people here with me. We can do it together. So that's how it started. And I'm on this journey of building a community of courage so that we can all just raise each other up.
Yeah. And your podcast has been getting rave reviews, has it not?
It has been amazing, like overwhelmingly amazing, Nicole. I can't even believe it. The first week that we launched, there were close to 1,000 downloads. So that is kind of affirming that people either want to hear about courage, or they just want to hear me talking to friends.
So what has been your favorite story that you've shared on the podcast so far?
Oh my gosh, there's so many good ones. One that really stands out to me is in the initial launches from my friend Ailey in Scotland, and she's an identity coach. And she talks all about why identity is important and what comprises our identity. And that really is the root of who we are, right? Like when we're clear about who we are, what we want, then we can go for it. Just like with fitness, you know, if we're really clear on like one of my core values is being healthy, I know that I'm going to incorporate fitness into my regular routine. But if I'm like, you know what, I don't really care about that, it might not be, it might be something else that drives our health and fitness journey.
So in the beginning, you had talked about the year of courage. And do you ever kind of dabble into like the people pleaser aspect? Because that's what I find when a lot of times when I feel like people don't want to step out of their comfort zone, or they don't want to do anything that scares them, is a lot of times they're afraid that people are going to say something negative towards them. Like I know, especially women, they come to me and they're like, well, I could never go into the gym and lift weights with, you know, all the guys standing around me or whatever. And, or I could never go to a park and work out in front of everybody because they're so worried about what other people are thinking. And what I always find is ironic is I bet you if we polled the people that were around, they're probably not even paying attention, or they're probably feeling something about themselves rather than about, you know, the person. So do you have anything, like, did you feel that way at all in your year of courage?
Oh my gosh, so much. And the group of coworkers that I work, we were always seeking the boss's approval. Like everyone in that group, it was what this person thought of you. And at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter, right? It's just a job. And if you like yourself and value what you're doing, that is the most important. But like you said, it's not easy. You know, like if you're going out to the park and you're like, I feel good, I'm out here, I'm working out, like, yay, look at me, right? But that's not easy. I work out at Pure Bar and they just opened the outdoor fitness. And so there's like a little patch of grass in the downtown area that you can work out. And so as we're like bending down and kicking our legs in the air, of course people are walking by, and you can be shy about it, because, or you could just be like, this is part of the workout. I'm going for it. I'm going to make the most of my time here. So yeah, that's one way to think about it.
I know growing up in the dance world, it was like you were always trying to seek the approval of the director, of the, you know, dance teacher, of whoever. And there was definitely a pecking order in the dance realm. And I don't know, I know we talked off saying you had done some dancing when you were younger.
Yeah.
But I know for me, anywhere I went, the dance studio I grew up in, and even in when I danced in professional ballet companies, there was always a spot at the bar, and the like the best dancer had her spot. And then, you know, there was a pecking order as to who where everybody stood, which is really fascinating. Because it's just a room, you know. I know in one situation, the best dancer got the best spot because it was in front of the mirror that made them look the thinnest. Like, I don't know how far you delved into that, but I find it, like looking back now as an adult, I find it very fascinating that, you know, how much it's been ingrained in my life that, you know, you want people to like you, you want people to relate to you and, you know, get their attention, that kind of thing, which is interesting.
For sure. And I think the one person or two people that we really want that to is from our parents too, right? Like, I want my parents to be proud of me. And just hearing what you're saying with the attention of the directors, with my year of courage, my mom and I are very similar in personality, but also very different. I don't know if any of your listeners share that relationship with a mom. But my mom is like very direct with feedback. So for example, she watched my interview on Brilliantly Resilient and she's like, I have two pieces of feedback for you. I'm like, okay, go for it. And she's like, your lighting wasn't good and your bangs were in your eyes the whole time. And I'm like, okay, thanks for your feedback. And I grew up with that, so I'm really comfortable with it, right? But for some people listening, they're like, oh my gosh, like, ouch. But sometimes my mom will say things, give me feedback that I don't want feedback on or that is hard to hear, especially as I'm raising 2 4-year-old boys. And I've learned to speak up to her and really kindly. And I just say, Mom, right, I hear what you're saying and that's not helpful. And she'll be like, oh, okay, I'm sorry. And like, we're like, our adult relationship is really interesting and changing and transforming. And I'm really enjoying where it's going, but she wouldn't know any of that stuff if I didn't speak up or say anything. She wouldn't know that it was bothering me or I wanted a different type of relationship. So I think it's really beneficial to speak up, as hard as it may be.
That's interesting that you say that. I actually have the opposite with my parents. And it's interesting because I have I have two brothers and a sister, and I have always been the one that has spoke my mind. And like, even if, like, it's horrible, they're like, tell us how you really feel, Nicole, you know, like, so I never had a problem telling them, you know, different things, and probably much to their chagrin. But I just went over and I was over visiting my parents, and it's interesting from my perspective, just because I've dived so deeply into psychology lately. And it's interesting how when your mind shifts a little bit, like, you see things in a different way. And I'm looking at, I'm throwing my mom under the bus, but I'm looking at my mom going like, were you always like this? Like, how did I not? Not that there's anything wrong with it, but it's just, it's very eye-opening. And I agree with you, as you know, as we get older and as we change our thoughts and the way we think about things and the things that we're doing, it's interesting how your perspective just changes on, you know, like, as a kid, most people look up to their parents as like infallible and, you know, and their parental figure, which I think is normal. And then as you get older, you're like, oh, wait a minute, they're human too, you know? So Ming, on the Courage Up podcast, you've had some phenomenal guests on there. So if you could you like pick out some of the best tips from your podcast so far?
Yeah. All right. So one of the guests was myself, but not really. I was talking about Abby Wambach's book, The Wolf Pack. And it is so good that she talks about these new rules versus old rules. So one example is, she talks about the old rule is be grateful. And the new rule is be grateful and demand more. And a lot of times women, we sit at the seat and we're just thinking like, oh, I'm so grateful for everything that I've given. And we become a little bit complacent. She was saying how when she was accepting her lifetime award next to Kobe and Peyton Manning, that the trajectories of their lives were very different. They had like millions and millions of dollars left, and she didn't know where her next mortgage was going to come from. And so I think, especially as women, we can be grateful of our opportunities, but it's also important that we say, and we also would like this.
I love that. That is awesome, because I think gratitude definitely is a part of it, and we should, you know, definitely need to be grateful for everything that we have. But I think as women, we are uncomfortable with wanting more. Like, it's a bad thing that we want more. And I think in certain instances, not food, but in certain instances, I think for sure there is nothing wrong with wanting more.
Absolutely. Yeah, and asking for it. Yeah. A silly example I give on my podcast is that I'm grateful that my a friend talked about how she was grateful her husband got the coffee ready in the morning, and she's going to ask him to make it right because he wasn't doing it correctly. So that's a really silly example, but oftentimes we just feel so grateful that we are invited to be at the seat of the table that we don't ask for more. So that was one of them. Another one, I interviewed Dr. Hans. He's a finance and investment expert, and he just talked about how it's important for us to build financial wealth and the courage to invest in stocks. And we often think that, hey, if we have debt, let's just like pour it all towards debt and build the savings, and we don't think about the investment. And he really shared it's three pieces of the pie that you save for your savings, like your 6 month whatever fund, you pay off your debt, and you invest to continue to build your financial wealth. And that, I think finances can be a little bit scary because there's a lot of unknown. And he just really helped open my eyes to what the possibilities are.
Awesome. We had a guest on, Eileen Ward, who also a financial advisor. And I learned so much just talking to her, because I think most women, I don't want to generalize, but most women don't really understand their finances or have any desire to, as long as they can buy those Jimmy Choo shoes or whatever. It's all good. Yeah, but I think definitely learning, you know, what you can do with your money is definitely helpful for sure.
Yeah. I remember just like, do I have enough to buy groceries and all that stuff when we don't really plan for the next part?
Yeah.
And then another guest that was just on there is Brandy Edwards. She talks about how to live a courageous life. And for her, she really wanted to speak at a women's workshop. She went to a lot of women's retreats and entrepreneur workshops, and she's like, I want to do that. So instead of waiting for someone to host one for her and invite her, she did it herself. So she came up with her own self-love challenge workshop. She got women there and just created it. So her big takeaway that I got was, don't wait for other people around to pick you. You choose you and make opportunities happen for yourself. So that was really awesome.
That is good too. I think a lot of people just sit around waiting for like divine intervention a lot of times, and that's not usually the way it works.
Right? Or like, oh, if it's meant to be, then the universe will make it happen for me. Yeah. And yes, I believe there's a part of that, but you got to do the work too, right? Like you got to go out there and make it happen.
Yeah. And I know in self-help, I'm not, if you guys have followed me, you know, I'm not really into like the woo part but I, the whole like manifesting, which I think is kind of a loaded word to begin with, because I think a lot of people think, oh, I'll just chant and I'll just sit here and magical things will happen to me. But the other part of manifesting is taking massive action to get what you want. And a lot of people miss that step, or they take some action, and but it's not enough to propel them and to push them into what they really want.
Look at this post-it that I have as you were talking.
There you go. There you go.
It says massive action for those of you listening and not watching.
Yeah, I know you guys can't see and I can't turn the camera, but I actually made like a, I took a poster board and I put different sayings of things on there. I spent one Sunday morning just kind of making, it's sort of like a vision board, but it's just quote. It's not even quotes. It's like just, you know, and one of them is take massive action daily. Show up 100%. And so there are all these little things. So every time when I'm working on my desk or interviewing people and I glance up, I'll notice one of the things and I'm like, oh yeah, I needed to read that.
That's awesome. Yeah. I love that.
So Ming, tell everyone where they can find you online.
So you can find me all things Ming Shelby. So what that means is you can find me on mingshelby.com at my website. It has a little bit more about me. And if you want to book me for any speaking events, you can head there. You can also find me on Instagram at Ming Shelby, on Twitter at Ming Shelby, at LinkedIn at Ming Shelby, all the Ming Shelbys. And then you can find the Courage Up podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and Google Play. So I really hope that your listeners reach out and tune in. I'd love to connect with them.
Yeah, definitely take a listen to her podcast. And if you missed any of the links, even though it's pretty straightforward, it's Ming Shelby.
And I don't know if you know that many Ming Shelbys, but I have not found another one.
You are the first Ming Shelby I've ever met. But you can also go to shapeitupfitness.com and just click on this episode and you will get all the show notes because they will be there as well. All right, Ming, are you ready for the speed round?
Yes, I am. I can't wait. Maybe a little nervous too.
Maybe. It's okay. All right. Question number one, do you like coffee or tea?
Tea. I don't like coffee at all. I can't actually stand the smell of it.
We can't be friends anymore.
I know. Did you make that Dalgona coffee during quarantine? Everyone was making like this whipped coffee.
No, I never even heard of it. I've been a big coffee drinker since like my teens. I used to have a mug, like when you put it up, it was bigger than my face. Like I would drink 2 pots of regular coffee a day when I was dancing. I had no concept of nutrition at that time, like, and no water. It was just coffee and caffeinated, lots of creamer, lots of sugar. That is how I got through my life in my 20s.
I'm sure a lot of people can relate.
Yeah. No, I actually worked as a barista. When I lived in Annapolis, Maryland, I got up at like 5 a.m. and got out on my bike. I lived a couple blocks away from the coffee house and I would ride my bike and open up the coffee place. And I love the smell of the beans and like the roast and yeah. So, but that I don't know. So I don't know what did you call it again?
Dalgona. It's a Korean term. It's, so it's instant coffee whipped and then there's
stuff right there. That's why.
No. But then it has like cream. It's cream on top and I'm going to send you a picture. It was like COVID sensation. Everybody was drinking it. I think it's sweeter. So I don't know if you like your coffee sweet or not, but
I used to, I try, like I can drink black coffee. That doesn't bother me. I honestly only put like a little bit of creamer. I don't even put sugar and it's unsweetened creamer. It's coconut. What is it?
You're the real deal.
Well, it's cause I started with like a ton of sugar and creamer. And then my heart was like, no, you can't have any more caffeine. I think you're done. And then I switched to decaf and now I have like half calf. So. But yeah, I just love the taste. I mean, that was one of the things when we were in COVID, I said to my husband, I was like, as long as I have my creamer, we're good. And coffee.
That is so funny. So I love Starbucks, but I don't drink coffee. I just love their chai tea lattes.
Like chai. Chai is delicious. Mm-hmm. All right. So we all, most of us, have had some unique and special job in our past that we may or may not have enjoyed. So like I always give the example, I used to sit for portrait painting when I was ballet dancer to make extra money. And then there was another incident where I worked at a pizza place where I had to dress up. Like Saturday was like clown day, kid day, and I refused to wear the hair. So have you had a job like that?
I've had, you know, this is so funny. I was a lifeguard, which is funny because I don't really know how to swim. So I just passed that like 100 yard, whatever, like I flailed through that. But I would say the most interesting job I had was I was in high school and I was visiting my family in Taiwan. Most of them live in Taiwan and they have all these like cram schools where you go and learn extra. And the owner of the place, she asked if I wanted to teach English because I'm a native English speaker and they wanted me to learn the accent. So I was making $20 an hour as like a high school tutor. And I just thought that was the best gig, but it was really hard because I was like, I don't really know what I'm doing here.
It's so funny that they wanted to learn the accent.
Like, yeah, because they wanted it to sound natural.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, yeah.
Very cool. I guess, now, are you from Taiwan? Like, did you grow up there or were you born in America?
So I was born in Taiwan, but I came to the United States when I was 6 months old. So I feel like that doesn't really count. But I still can't be president of the United States ever.
Darn.
I know.
I don't know if I'd want that job.
It seems kind of high pressure and stress. But then I was there in second grade. I went to school for a year in Taiwan, and then the rest has all been in the States.
Oh, cool. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is your favorite book and why?
My favorite book? Oh, Nicole, this is hard. I have like so many that I love.
Pick the first one that came to your mind.
I mean, the first one that came to my mind is Dare to Lead by Brené Brown. It's so good. The one of the lines that sticks out in my mind always is, clear is kind, unclear is unkind.
Clear as in, go ahead.
Yeah. So like when we're being really clear with expectations that we want of our kids, our spouses, our coworkers, if we have a really,
I'm sorry to interrupt, but not like, it's ironic that that sentence was not clear to me.
You just needed a second to process.
Go ahead, say what you're saying.
Yeah, so that's kind. Like, we're giving people, we're letting them know clear, transparent communication, understanding. And we're unclear when we're like, well, you know, and da-da-da-da. And then people kind of have to read between the lines. That's unkind, because then we have to be like, no, that's not how I wanted it. But we didn't say that ever in the beginning. So it's all about being a great leader. And
what is your favorite movie?
This is a hard, okay. My favorite genre is romantic comedies. I love romantic comedies. I don't know why, but they just like hit the spot.
Oh, I agree. Were we talking about Hugh Jackman off camera before?
Maybe. This sounds familiar. Oh, because yes, we were talking about Greatest Showman.
Yes, yeah.
Yes, so, I actually haven't seen
For the
that.
Listeners, because this is not our own personal conversation, Ming asked me to be on her podcast, and we were talking about songs, and I was talking about Hugh Jackman, how I'm a big fan of his, and I think I was supposed to send you the video, the movie that I was titled that I was talking about, and I completely forgot, so I'll have to send it to you. But for those Hugh Jackman fans, I'll have to find the title, but it was him and I can picture her. I can't think of her name. Okay. The movie is Someone Like You. And
with Ashley Judd.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
Ashley Judd and Greg Kinnear. Great movie. Marissa Tomei was in it. Yeah. A really good movie.
Yes.
With Hugh Jackman. It's an older one. I forget.
I have seen it.
It's a good flick.
It's really good.
So I'm sorry, I interrupted you again.
That's okay.
What is your favorite movie?
So I think my favorite would have to be When Harry Met Sally, like an old classic rom-com.
I love that movie. That is one of my favorites. I know in high school, my friends and I, we used to quote from the movie all the time. Kind of like how people quote from Friends, which I do that occasionally. But yeah, that was a great movie. Yeah, for anybody who has never seen When Harry Met Sally, you definitely have to check it out. Great movie.
It's on Amazon Prime right now, I think, with quarantine. So I just recently rewatched it.
Okay.
Now, fun fact, did you know when they were doing the carpet and buying, and that he's like making those funny sounds, and he's like, wah, 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 wah. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. I haven't watched it in a while, but yeah, I can picture them with the rug.
You can cut this part out of the interview.
No, that's okay. Go.
He turns and looks at the camera, and then he like keeps going. Like, oh, Meg Ryan turns and looks at the camera, and then they keep going, because that whole part was improv. He like Billy Crystal made up that whole section.
I believe it. Yeah.
Isn't that fun?
Robin Williams was another one that who I love. Like, that he used to improvise a lot in his movies, and they just left it. Like Mrs. Doubtfire. It really shows the actor side of, you know, their real personality, I think. So, yeah,
for sure.
But great, great movie. Yeah. Thank you. And I remember watching it going, that was Princess Leia.
Who?
Carrie Fisher.
Oh Oh my gosh, the friend.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a confession. I've never seen any of the Star Wars movies.
Oh my gosh. We really can't be friends. No. We are big Star Wars fans here, for sure.
Are you?
Yeah. Yeah. It's okay. I have never seen, we should play I Never Seen. Yeah. I have never seen Rocky, and I live in South Jersey, and we're pretty much next to Philadelphia, and I keep joking that people are going to kick me out of Jersey because I ever watched
Yeah, don't you have the whole staircase thing?
Yeah, in Philly? Yeah.
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 I've actually never seen Rocky either, Nicole. Mm.
Okay, then we can be friends.
Yeah, we can be friends. I'll have to watch it. We can watch it together.
Yeah. All right, so last question. What is your favorite inspirational quote?
Oh my gosh, Nicole. I'm really going to have to think about this one. Okay. This one's by Maya Angelou, but I have to pull it up because I don't want to mess it up. All right. This is a quote by the wonderful Maya Angelou. If you're always trying to be normal, you will never know how amazing you can be.
I like that one.
I try to keep that in mind when I'm always trying to be like, I feel like I can be a little bit out there for people, like very enthusiastic and gregarious. And so I always try to tone it down, but then I'm like, then I can't, I'm just trying to be like everybody else. So there you go.
I like that one. I wish I could think of it off the top of my head. My daughter had said something and I quoted her. It's on, if you follow me, you'll see it. It'll pop up in the feed at some point. But basically it was something like, why be average when you can be extraordinary or something like that? And I was like,
I love that.
You're like 10.
Yeah, she's so wise, Nicole. You're raising a wise girl.
Wise beep, maybe. No, I have two very wonderful children. I can't complain. So.
Was that one of them?
I think so. They're listening. They've been very good with the podcast, for sure. All right, Ming, we're going to wrap up. Can you give one takeaway that the listeners can use for taking the courage to do something?
Yeah. All right. So this is simple, but sometimes can be hard to do. If you ever have that voice inside your head that's like, I really want to try, and then immediately the negative voice comes up with the reasons why you can't, but what if, all of those, shut out those negative voices and just go for it. Just do it. You can do a quick countdown like Mel Robbins says, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and just do it, because I promise you, you will feel so much better going for it than having the regret of not ever trying.
Yes, for sure. Awesome. So Ming, thank you so much for being on the show today. I hope everybody doesn't think that we've been drinking heavily before this episode.
Thank you so much for having me on your show, Nicole. It's been so wonderful chatting with you and sharing with your audience.
All right. Well, thank you everybody for listening, and I will talk to you next week. So Ming, wait a minute. So Ming,
I know the start is always awkward. I'm with you. I'm like totally with you on that.
I'm gonna have to do outtakes.
Okay, I had to sneeze, but it's gone now.
That's okay. Say grapefruit. That's what we used to do on stage.
Grapefruit.
You say grapefruit, and then you won't sneeze. It's very hard to hold a pose and be like.
Oh, I have to talk about Abby Wambach.
Does that name sound familiar?
She's a soccer star, yeah.
Oh, that's why.
Okay, so
my daughter's into soccer.
How old is your daughter?
She's 13. We went and saw Carly Lloyd. She was at an event, and we sat right in the front row, and my daughter got to ask her a question, and Mom of the Year turned to videotape her question. And then I turned to Carly when she answered it. And as I turned to Carly, my Kenzie, my daughter, she goes, You didn't hit record, Mom.
Oh, no.
So I got Carly's response, but I didn't get her question. So at the end, I was like, we'll just do a retake.
Oh, her asking the question. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your cookbook came in the mail this weekend.
Yay. Do you like it?
I'm so excited. Yes. Like, there's, of course, the recipes with pictures stand out, you know? So I'm like, and the color, it was a good call of changing that. Cause I was like, I want to try that strawberry banana wrap. I'm like, Oh, that Thanksgiving Day meatloaf looks good too. So,
oh my gosh, that is so good. If you are looking for quick and easy meals to put together that have minimal cleanup time, then I want to introduce you to the No Fuss, No Mess, Shape It Up cookbook. This is perfect for the non-chef who wants quick meals, minimal cleanup time, and a smaller waistline. Inside your cookbook includes healthy recipes with easy-to-find ingredients, time savers in the kitchen, easy cleanup, and most meals are made in one pot. Spend less time in the kitchen and more time doing the things that you love. The No Fuss, No Mess, Shape It Up cookbook. Now available at Amazon.com.